John 5:8. Jesus saith unto him, rise, take up thy bed, and walk. Now let's read that again. Jesus saith unto him, rise, take up thy bed, and walk. Now go ahead and put Acts chapter 7 up there, Nicole, because today I want to preach about the contradiction. Acts chapter 7, verse 22. And Moses was learned in all the wisdom of the Egyptians, and was mighty in words and in deeds. Now I want you to notice right there, the Bible said that Moses was mighty in his words and deeds. Right there, the Bible said that Moses was a good speaker. Right there, the Bible said that Moses was able to move people with his speech. Is that not what it says right there in Acts chapter 7, verse 22? It says that. Now I want you to look at Exodus chapter 4, verse 10. And Moses said unto the Lord, O my Lord, I am not eloquent, neither heretofore, nor since thou spoken to thy servant, but I am slow of speech and of a slow tongue. I want you to notice right there, I pointed out a seeming contradiction in the Word of God. Because when Stephen, when the author of Acts is explaining Moses, he said, man, Moses could preach, Moses could talk, Moses could move people. The way he talked was powerful. But yet we flipped on over to Exodus chapter 4, verse 10, and Moses himself says, I can't talk a lick. I have a stuttering problem, and there's no way God could use my voice to help anybody. And many skeptics have looked at these two scriptures and said, see, there's contradictions in the Bible. The Bible contradicts itself, therefore you can't believe it. I want to preach a little bit about a contradiction, because these two things aren't separate, but God uses them to show us a powerful truth about Him and about life. I want to preach a little while about the contradiction. Because as you sit under the sound of my voice today, you've got things in your life that make you believe in God. You can look back over your life and you can see times that if it had not been for God that was on your side, you wouldn't have made it. Many of you can recall car wrecks that you shouldn't have walked away from, relationships you shouldn't have got out of, dark seasons that you thought would never end, but somehow God made a way when there seemed to be no way. There are many of you under the sound of my voice today that you have stone cold evidence that there's a God. Not only have you felt His moving in your heart, not only have you been blessed by the hand of God, but you've got some things in your life that testify to you of the goodness of God. Every time I look at my wife and my children, it reminds me I serve a good, good God. Every time I run around with one of my friends and we laugh, it reminds me I've got a good, good God. Every time I wake up in the morning and can breathe and see the air and the beauty, it reminds me we've got a good, good God. Some of you ought to put your hands together right now if you know you've got a good, good God. We got evidence that there's a God. You get up in the mountains. Me and Pastor Bobby were hunting one morning on top of a big ridge. I ain't going to tell you what happened because you couldn't handle it, but we were on top of a big ridge, and Bobby said, how can you look at this and think there is no God? The Bible itself says creation testifies that there is a God. We got some evidence that there's a God. You got up and came to church this morning because there's something in you that knows that there's a God that loves you, that there's a God that you can reach out to. There is a God that hears you when you pray. We all got some evidence. We've got some diehard facts on the inside of us. It may not be something you can see, but the very fact that we look over our life and it says, man, I know God brought me through that. I know God helped us out of that. I know God heard me when I prayed that prayer. We've all got that about us, and we love to preach about that. And we love to shout about that. And we love to come in here and, like the book of Acts says, confirm the faith with that, because you need that. But there's a lot of times you go through the flip side of that and ain't nobody talking about that.
Come on, Pastor.
And that's the stuff in your life that tries to talk you out of your faith. That's the things going on in your life that you can't talk about in testimony service. That's the struggle you got going on the inside that you don't know how to articulate and pontificate, and you're just thinking, man, this stuff's making me irate. That stuff going on in your life that makes you say, I don't feel like going to church this morning? Where's my honest crowd at? That stuff going on in your life that makes you look up in heaven and wonder, God, do you still love me? God, are you still there? God, do you even care? What about the contradictions in your life? Because I've stood up here and boldly told you I got some stuff that tells me my God is real and my God is awesome. I got stuff in my life that tries to talk me out of my faith. Talk me out of my peace. We're going to get real this morning. That stuff that goes on you can't explain. That struggle you got that you wish to God you hadn't got. Holler back at me, somebody. That thing that you deal with basically on a daily basis, that weight that you carry that nobody sees. Apostle Paul, I thank God Apostle Paul was the realest preacher in the Bible. That he wrote 2/3 of the New Testament. That the Bible declares him as a powerful mouthpiece that God used. But I thank God he gave us some insight into the struggle. Because the problem is you've got so many people coming to church and they're struggling and they think they're all alone. They're going through a battle and they think nobody else has ever been through that battle. When the Bible said there's no temptation taking you, but that which is common to man. But David said this, when I kept silent, my bones waxed old. See, if the enemy can keep you silent about your struggle, help me, Holy Ghost. If the enemy can keep us trying to put on the church face and act like we always got it all together, you ain't helping nobody. God didn't bring you in here to impress somebody. God brought you in here to bless somebody. And every now and then you need to pull your mask off and say, I know what it feels like to have a bad day. I know what it feels like to want to give up. I got any real people in here? Because sometimes what will help your faith is not some pious preacher standing over you saying, I don't struggle like that. Sometimes what will help you is somebody getting real, Brother Ben. Saying, Brother, I've been through that battle. I've had those thoughts. I've struggled with those weaknesses. We all have the contradictions for everything that's in our life that we can praise God for. There's always that nagging thing that the enemy wants to point us to and say, if God really loves you, why you got that struggle? If God's really on your side, why'd you go through that? If God's really saved you, why are you still battling with that? And so now you've got the voice of the Holy Ghost pointing you to all the blessings. But you always got the yell of the enemy trying to get you to look at things that don't matter. He's a master of making a mountain out of a molehill and trying to talk you out of your faith. The enemy is a master of making you look at people around you and thinking they got it better off than you do. Not realizing they put their britches on just like you. They have the same battles you have. They fight the same devil you fight. And they need the same Jesus you need. We're all in this thing together. Honey, we got people that can pray you through some battles because they fought some battles themselves. We got people that can stand with you through the hard time because they've had some hard times of their own. Paul said, I got battles without and I got fears within in 2 Corinthians 7:5. See, so everybody got battles without. Everybody's fighting stuff on their job, in their, you know, in life, worried about their kids. We all got the battles. You ain't gonna get through life without having some adversity and having some struggle. Greg's had battles, but look where he is this morning. He's at the house of God. We all got battles. And if Greg can praise God, we can praise God. God brings Greg here to remind us we all got a reason. But it's one thing to have a battle on the outside. But what do you do when you're battling on the outside? Paul said, not only was I fighting on the outside, I had people wanting to kill me, people coming against me, people struggling with me. He said, but I had some fears I was dealing with on the inside. I thank God for Apostle Paul because he let us know that in life sometimes, even though you fight stuff on the outside, you're going through stuff on the inside you can't even talk about. And everybody sees the battle you're thinking, fighting on the outside, and they think, man, that's tough. But you're thinking, buddy, if you had any idea what I had going on between my ears, if you had any idea what I'm fighting internally, you may see me fighting outwardly, but my biggest battle's on the inside. I got any people in here that would admit that the biggest battle you fight ain't no devil out there, but it's the battle between your ears. I've got good news for you. The same see what they're fighting with out there, what they're jabbing at, what they're moving with. But you have no idea what they're dealing with in here. It's hard to judge somebody unless you walked where they walked. Unless you've been where they've been. That's the problem with the church. We always see the outward battle. But we ain't got no sensitivity for the inward struggle that people go through. If you saw what some people had to go through just to get here this morning. If you saw the tears some people have cried this week that they can't never tell you about, you wouldn't judge them. You would hold them up in prayer and say, God, help my brother and help my sister make it. It's those inward struggles that talk people out. It's those inward struggles that make people give up. I can handle what's going on out here if I got peace in here. The Bible said so. The Bible said the spirit of a man will sustain his infirmity. It didn't say he wouldn't have an infirmity, but it said if his spirit was strong, he could take it. But the Bible said, but a wounded spirit. Help me, Holy Ghost. The Bible said a wounded spirit, who can bear? See, the enemy knows, yeah, Bobby's going to have battles. Bobby's going to have struggles. And he's man enough to take it because God's equipped him. But the enemy says, if I can wound his spirit, if I can take a piece of Cody's soul out of him, then things he used to beat will start beating him. This is good preaching, y'all.
Come on.
Then things he used to have victory over a year ago are going to start trampling him underfoot. What do you do with the contradictions of life? Because for everything that makes you want to lift your hands and praise God, there's always that voice that makes you think, God, you listening to me? Do you help me? Do you love me? Are you with Smith Wigglesworth? Was one of the most powerful preachers of the early 1900s. He prayed before he passed away and passed on his anointing to Lester Sumrall. Smith Wigglesworth had 14 documented cases of people being risen from the dead. Smith Wigglesworth, every day of his life, he would get somebody saved. He was a powerful man of God. Before he would preach, he would just pace back and forth and pray. And he wouldn't take the stage until he felt something. And one day somebody asked him, they said, what are you waiting on, Brother Wigglesworth? He said, I'm waiting for my help to come.
Amen.
Because he knew he couldn't do nothing if God didn't help him do it.
Amen.
He was a powerful man of God. And he would pray for people and tumors would fall off and great things would happen. But what the public didn't know is Smith Wigglesworth would go home many times from those meetings. And he would have such crippling kidney stones, he'd have to lay flat on his back for hours. I've never had a kidney stone, thank you, Jesus. But everybody I've ever heard tell of it, they said it's a bad thing. I remember when Jay had that kidney stone. I remember one time Bishop Jack King was preaching and a kidney stone hit him and he dropped to his knees. They say it's a terrible thing. And Smith Wigglesworth was afflicted with kidney stone. And when he would be laying there on his back, the enemy would come and try to talk him out of his ministry. And say, how is it you pray for all these other people and God moves, but yet you can't even get yourself better? And it would be at those moments that his faith would be tested. Have you ever been there? It may not be kidney stones, but in other struggles in life. And that's when the enemy comes. He don't come when you're up on the mountain and things are going good, but he gets you when the doors are closed and the lights are off. And then he comes and he points out every flaw, every struggle, every weakness, and says, if God is really for you, the contradiction. Can you imagine the contradiction of the great Smith Wigglesworth standing in front of hundreds of God moving and people getting saved? But yet when he goes home and closes the door, he lays in pain and agony many times in his life. It was in those moments that the enemy tried to tell him, God is no longer with you. But Brother Smith Wigglesworth had this mindset. He said, God, I believe your grace is sufficient. And I just come to tell somebody that whatever ain't moved when you need it to move, God's grace is still sufficient. He will carry you through. He will not let that thing overtake you. God said, as your days are, so shall your strength be. God will never let you see a day that his grace can't carry you through. God will never let you fight a battle that God won't make a way. I need somebody to give God a praise. If you believe he'll make a way when there seems to be no way. I feel this morning. Because you've all been flat on your back at some point.
Amen.
You've all had your own Wigglesworth moment where you're laying there and you're thinking, God, where are you? Jesus on the cross. My God, himself had turned his back on Yeshua. And now you've got these contradictions in life, these struggles that you go through, these things that try to talk you out. Paul said, I got battles without, but I got fears within. We got those fears we deal with. We got those struggles that we deal with. Jesus came not just to do outward wonders that woo people, but Jesus came to touch the inward things that people deal with. Amen. In John chapter 5, the Bible said there was a man that had been laying there for 38 years waiting for something to happen, waiting for something to change, waiting for something to move. And it hadn't happened. He'd been waiting there for years, y'all. And the Bible said, I'm going to get him to go ahead and put this bed on the stage so y'all can see it. He laid on the bed. This is what they brought into the house of God on, waiting on something to move. Maybe this is you this morning. And he would wait for something to happen, wait for something. And it never did until Jesus showed up. Listen, sometimes man can give you momentary relief, but ain't nothing really ever going to change until you let Jesus show up in your life. The Bible said, y'all know the story, so I won't re-preach the story. But the Bible said that Jesus, somebody just say Jesus. The Bible said that Jesus healed this man. This man that had been carried on this bed. See, every time I see somebody come to the altar, I realize they're laying their bed down. I realize they're laying the thing that they were connected to and bound to, that depression, that addiction, that struggle, that fear, that shame, that guilt. The bed is that thing that you feel like it's always going to be toting you around from one bad mood to another bad mood, from one bad day to another bad day. And the man felt like he was always going to be at the mercy of the bed. But things changed when Jesus came, because when Jesus spoke to him, freedom came to this man. And Jesus, the first thing he told him was rise. I just want somebody to know that no matter what situation's going on in your life, my God says you can get up. My God says you ain't got to stay down. I just come to somebody that's dealing with depression, I say rise. I come to talk to somebody dealing with addiction, I say rise. I come to talk to somebody going through a struggle, I feel like James Brown, get on up. If you've been in a bad place, God says you can get up. I don't care what the doctor said, I don't care what the lawyer said, honey, I'm preaching what Jesus said. You rise up out of that situation. Rise up. I don't care how many years, I don't care how many people know about it, my God will get you up. And you would think with that way of preaching, especially as being Pentecostal, y'all, that that would have been the end of the story. And the bed would have been left right there. And he would have never had to look at that bed again. You would think that's the way the story would end, right? But right after Jesus told him to rise, he said, but before you go, take up your bed and walk. I feel my help coming right now.
Come on.
Because now people are looking at him and they can still see the bed. Now people looking at him, he's been called to help other people. And the first thing they're going to say is, how you going to help me when you got that bed on your shoulder? And that's when the man had to explain to him, no, you don't understand. This bed is not a limitation. It's a reminder. It's a reminder of what God got me out of. It's a reminder that my God made a way when there didn't seem to be no way. Yeah, it might still be a part of my life, but it don't carry me anymore. I carry it. Yeah, I might still have some temptation. I might still have some struggle. I might still have some weakness. But baby, it ain't got control of me anymore. I got control of it. Yes, I'm still human. And yes, I remember where I came from. But I'm telling you right now, I ain't who I used to be. No, I may not be who I should be, but I ain't who I used to be. I'm carrying it, and it ain't carrying me. If I'm preaching to anybody that says I'm carrying what used to carry me, you ought to give God a praise right now. You ain't as bad off as you used to be. You're not as messed up as you used to be. You're not as hopeless as you used to be. Oh, somebody. still be a part of my life. But it don't rule me no more, Chris. Yeah, I remember how bad off I was. Yeah, there are days that my bed is evident. If you can see me in the spirit every time I'm trying to help somebody else, I got my bed on me. I still got my bed, brother. I still got my bed. I ain't perfect. I ain't got it all together. If you get too close to any preacher, any man of God, you can find out they still got a bed and they carry it too. Because the only perfect one that ever hit this planet, they crucified. But the reason I love him like I do, and the reason I preach like I do, and the reason I'm thankful like I am, is because I still got a reminder of what he brought me out of. The bed ain't been left in my life to hold me back or break me down. God left the bed in my life to remind me of what he did for me all those years ago. And the bed that he left in my life gives me mercy for the people that I preach to. Every time, Freddie, I get ready to judge somebody real hard, and I get ready to get real mad at somebody, I feel the weight of my bed. Every time I get ready to get real hard on somebody, Chris and Moose, they grew up with me. Every time I get ready to start feeling real good, you know, I feel that bed. And you know what the bed does? It keeps me from pointing the finger. And it makes me want to lend a hand. See, some of you, y'all feel me right now because you still got the bed in your life. It feels like a contradiction. The devil points at your bed and says, look, it's still there. Look, you still got it. You still got that temper. You still got that weakness. You still got that proclivity. You still got that thing. Yeah. We all got a cross to bear. Paul had a bed that stuck with him forever. He called it a thorn in the flesh. Hear me, somebody. 3 times he implored God. That means he put up a good case. He said, take it away. But God said, I'm leaving that there, Paul. Because that's going to remind you on your best day that you need me just as much then as you did back then. I dare you to make the devil mad right now and give God a praise for the bed. Because that bed's what got you here this morning. That bed's what reminded you to come to church. That bed's what keeps you from looking down your nose at somebody else. Take what the enemy tried to use to talk you out of your faith and say, God, I'm praising you that you left just enough to remind me that I need you, Jesus. I need you, Jesus. Everybody stand to your feet right now. See, devil hates preaching like this. Because it makes you think, yeah, I can get up and I can go forward. The devil hates preaching like this because it makes you think you can still lift your hands and God will still help you because he will. The enemy likes that kind of preaching where we say, oh, you still got a bed? Get out. Oh, you still got a struggle? Get out. That ain't the Bible. And that ain't Jesus. I want you to lift your hands all over this place. I feel the Holy Ghost. I don't know what your bed is. This bed could be addiction. This bed could be so many different reminders of yesterday and present struggles. But I want you to know God's greater than the bed. I come to church because that bed reminds me, boy, you need Jesus. And I'm preaching to some people today that know you need him just as much now as you did all them years ago. It don't matter what your bed is, and it don't matter how long it's been attached to you. If you say, I want God to turn this thing around for me,